Good evening. Good evening, everybody. It's wonderful as our procession of an angel comes up with his twinkling, around his thingamajig. Yes, he's just giving me a look as if to say, you weren't supposed to mention the twinkling tinsel. Right, good evening. My name is Michael Everett. I'm one of the clergy based here at Durham Cathedral, and I have a particular ministry in terms of welcoming and responding and working with the students of your university. And it's my tremendous joy and privilege to welcome you to this, the first of our carol services, the one for Durham Christian Union. It's particularly good to be able to welcome Glenn, who has come up from the deep south, all the way from Eastbourne, who is going to give the talk later on for this service. In the name of Jesus Christ, I welcome you as we prepare for Christmas, for that great celebration of Jesus' birth. When we gather tonight, following the light of Christ, traveling with Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem, and hearing angels and voices like angels as we proclaim the coming of the Prince of Peace, as we're reminded through Holy Scripture, prayer, pauses, music, all that God has done for us. And for that, we give thanks. And it is a joy for us to stand and sing our first carol, Joy to the World, the Lord is come.
Thank you. first reading is from Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother, Mary, had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband, Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. This reading is from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult in dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he shall be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace on the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. reading is from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the angels said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that's taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. Thanks be to God.
This reading is from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness, to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Thanks be to God.
These words are perhaps the most famous ever spoken. They are part of John's Gospel, which is the most translated part of the Bible, the world's all-time bestseller. And these words explain to us a great mystery. The mystery is this: why have we all just sung praises to a condemned criminal? Why have we come out to join our songs with the songs of millions around the world to praise a condemned criminal, a man who died under a capital charge? The Jews convicted him of blasphemy, the Romans of sedition, and yet this Jesus is the most famous person who has ever lived. He is a figure who has built civilizations, and in his name, great buildings like this have been founded. He is a figure who has drawn you here this evening. And yet, consider the man who we have just proclaimed Lord. He was born in a shed, laid in a feeding trough. He was born into abject poverty. He was a refugee for the early part of his life. During his adult years, he was a carpenter, swinging a hammer as his trade. And then one day, age 30, he put down his hammer and he started preaching, shooting his mouth off in a much derided part of Israel. In his mocked northern accent, he started telling stories about the way that he and his movement would take over the world. Who did he think he was? And then in his 30s, he was executed in a way the Romans devised so that nobody would follow in the footsteps of Jesus of Nazareth. Crucifixion was devised so that anybody seeing the wretched end made of that wretched man would run a mile. And yet Jesus is the central figure of human history. It is the year 2022, or to give it its fullest title, it's the year of our Lord, 2022. 2022 years since what? Since him. And he has pioneered what historian Tom Holland has called the most disruptive, the most influential, and the most enduring revolution in human history. Not bad for a kid born in a shed, wouldn't you say? And so how is it possible? How is it possible that we tonight are singing praises to this condemned criminal? John chapter 1 gives us the answer. The most famous words ever written concern the most famous man who ever lived. and they give us the origins story for Jesus. Jesus' life did not just begin in that manger. It did not just begin in Mary's womb. Jesus' beginning was before the beginning of the world. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Through Him, all things were made. Without Him, nothing was made that has been made. And in Him is life. That life is the light of all mankind. The biblical vision is not that Jesus invented a religion. The biblical vision is that Jesus invented the universe. He is the Word. What do words do? Words communicate. Words express. I can tell you something of my heart through my words to you. And there is good news. How do we know God? How do we know the Creator who was there in the beginning? Well, apparently, He has always had a word. He has always had a communication, an expression. Everything God wants to say is wrapped up in a person. And what a person. He's been proclaimed in these verses as one who is full of grace and truth. Jesus is the Word of God. And the good news is this. The God who is really there is entirely and utterly Christ-like. Isn't that good news? When you think of Jesus, the one to whom we have just sung, when you think of Him stooping and serving and suffering and bleeding and dying, do you know what you are seeing? You're seeing God. And you're seeing the kind of God who would stoop and serve and suffer and bleed and die for you. The biblical vision is that Jesus was there before the world began, the eternal Son of the Father, full of the Holy Spirit, which means that we have come from a fountain of light and life and love. I don't know what you picture when you picture God. The Bible says, picture Jesus. And in particular, picture Him filled by the Holy Spirit, loved by the Father. There has always been an eternal and cosmic Niagara Falls of light and life and love crashing down from the Father onto the head of the Son, Jesus Christ. It's good news that Jesus is the Word of God. Because Jesus reveals a very good God indeed. But then as the reading goes on, you recognize it's not just about the Word, it's also about the world. And I might wax eloquent about the light and life and love of God, but you look at the world that I look at, and you see darkness and death and disconnection, don't you? Where has that come from? This darkness that the light shines into. The Bible says that we have turned from light. And if you turn from light, where else do you go but darkness? When you turn from life, where else do you go but death? When you turn from love, where else do you go but disconnection? Love thwarted, twisted, denied, perverted. That's the world we live in, a world intended for light and life and love, a world that is shot through with darkness and death and disconnection. At this time of year, I start to think of Christmas trees. Do people have Christmas trees up yet? I think it's okay. It's not December, but I think it's okay to put up a Christmas tree, have you? So no, there's no shame if that's you. Maybe you've got a plastic tree up. Maybe you've got a real living tree. Maybe you've got a potted tree. I don't know. But let me tell you the story of a Christmas tree, because the story of a Christmas tree is like the story of you and me. Right around now, someone with an axe is going into a pine forest. And in the name of Christmas joy, they are hacking to death some pine tree. They are disconnecting it from its life source. And they are selling it to you. And you might bring it indoors, mightn't you? Bring it in from the cold. And as you purchase that Christmas tree, it doesn't look dead. It doesn't look dark. It doesn't look disconnected, does it? It looks vibrant and verdant and alive and alpine fresh. You bring it indoors and you dress it up in all sorts of decorations, all sorts of bling. And you surround it with festivities, family, and food. At some point, the needles start to drop. That's okay. You hoover up the needles. Little bits of brown start to appear. That's okay. You can hide it with the tinsel. And you continue the celebrations all the while that Christmas tree is perishing. That's a word that John's Gospel uses a lot to describe humanity. We're perishing. We're like a verdant pine tree disconnected from our life source. And we might look fantastic. We might smell alpine fresh. We might surround ourselves with fun and food and festivities. We might dress ourselves up in all sorts of performances and achievements, but we're disconnected. We're perishing. And we live in a world that is disconnected and perishing and dark. That's not good news, is it? We've thought about the Word, Jesus, who shows us a God of light, life, and love. We've thought about the world that is full of darkness, death, and disconnection. Let me give you a final W, though. The final W is good news. The worm. Any World Cup football fans? The worm. This time last week, Jack Grealish came from off the bench. And he scored the sixth goal against Iran. Anybody see it? And after his goal, there was a goal celebration. You know what he did? He did the worm. And people were laughing. Why is he doing the worm? Do you know why he did the worm? Look this up later. There are beautiful videos about why Jack Grealish did the worm after he scored the sixth goal against Iran. He promised it to a boy called Finley. Finley was a Man City fan, and he wrote to Jack Grealish, who plays for Man City, and he said, "I know your sister, Jack. Your sister has cerebral palsy." "I have cerebral palsy," said Finley. "I'd like to meet you. Could we meet?" And watch these videos. It's beautiful to see Jack and Finley meet together at training one day. And Finley says to Jack, "My dad plays me at football sometimes, but he never lets me win." And Jack Grealish says, "Why don't I join your team? I bet we'd win then." "Yeah, you'd definitely win with Jack Grealish, wouldn't you?" And then Finley said, "When you score your next goal, I want you to do something for me." Jack said, "Anything." Finley said, "I want you to do the worm." Jack said, "No, not the worm." "All right, I'll do it for you." And Jack thought the next time you'd do it would be in a Premier League game, maybe against Chelsea the next time he played. It wasn't. It was on the greatest stage of all, the World Cup. And Jack Grealish did not forget his promise to Finley Fisher. He scored that sixth goal and he looked like a fool. The eyes of the whole world on him. And then afterwards, he was asked why he did it in the post-match interview. And you'll never forget his words. He turned to the camera and he said, "That one was for you, Finley." And then he blew a kiss. The worm is good news for us. Because in John's Gospel, we learn about somebody who has been our champion. Somebody who has played a blinder for us. Somebody who has joined our team, Team Earth. A team headed for relegation.
a team full of darkness and death and disconnection. But John's gospel says, the Word who was there in the beginning, he became flesh and lived among us. And we've seen his glory, the glory of the only Son, full of grace and truth. You know what Jesus has done? The Son of the Father has become our brother at Christmas. He has joined Team Earth. And he said to all of us, you have opponents. You have enemies that always get the better of you, don't you? Just like Finley never won when he played backyard football. The Lord Jesus comes and he says, I'll team up with you. I'll play a blinder for you. I'll gain the victory for you. Do you have darkness? I'll shoulder the darkness with you. Do you have death? I'll experience that death for you. Do you have disconnection from God? I will suffer that disconnection for you on the cross. Because this is what love does, isn't it? When love sees the beloved in trouble, love says, your pain will be my pain. Your pit will be my pit. Your plight will be my plight. So who is Jesus? He's the Son of the Father who has come down to be with us in the pit, to be with us in the darkness, to take that darkness on himself, to take that death on himself, to take that disconnection on himself on the cross, and to rise up again and to say, you in the darkness, do you want my light? You in death, do you want my life? You in disconnection, do you want my love? And any who turn from that darkness and turn to Jesus, suddenly you get his Father as your Father. You get his Spirit as your Spirit. You get his victory as your victory. And he says what Jack Grealish said in that post-match interview. This is for you. It's for you. That's what Isaiah chapter 9 said. To us a child is born. To us the Son of God is given. What a Christmas gift. Imagine Jesus in the manger there. And a little gift tag around his ankle. With these words from John's gospel, with these words from Isaiah ringing in our ears, you can imagine what's written on the gift tag, can't you? It just says, from God to you. Have you received the true Christmas gift? To all who received him, to those who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children. Friends, this Christmas, you are offered the most extraordinary Christmas present. You're offered God the Son to be your champion, to be with you in the darkness and to give you his victory. Do not leave that Christmas present unopened. This Christmas, why not pick up John's gospel? You can find it online or perhaps you've got a Bible at home. Keep on reading. Keep on encountering this Jesus, who is full of grace and truth, because this Jesus is for you. Amen.
Thank you. I'm Dan.
And I'm Sarah. And on behalf of Durham Christian Union, we'd like to thank you all for coming tonight. As a Christian Union, we exist because we want to give every student in this city the opportunity to hear and respond to the good news of Jesus that Glenn spoke to us about tonight. This is why we put on events such as this carol service, and we'll have a week of events next term as well, where Glenn will be back to speak to us, and we'd love to see you all there. So keep an eye on the Durham CU socials for more details about that. But for tonight, we're so grateful that each one of you could be here, and we hope that you had a great time.
There are a few people that we need to thank for helping make this service happen. To thank the Reverend Canon Michael Hempel and the Reverend Canon Michael Everett, to Jill Chipchase and the cathedral staff and all the volunteers who have helped to put this on and whom we have the joy of partnering with each year. If you'd like to consider giving to the cathedral, there is more information in the booklets that are spread around. Thank you as well to Durham Choral Society for singing so beautifully to us, to John Forsyth and to Daniel Cook as well for leading us so ably in the carols. Thank you as well to Glenn for showing us the light of the world, the Lord Jesus, through whom we can find grace and truth and become children of God.
We would love to invite you all to join us after the service at Christchurch, which is on Claypath, or Leech Hall, which is in St. John's College, to enjoy free mince pies and mulled wine and to chat about what you've heard tonight. It is our hope and prayer that each one of you here tonight would come to know Jesus, that you would know the everlasting love of the Father, becoming part of his family and having his spirit within you.
To start off this journey, we have a few suggestions of what you could do next. Firstly, I encourage you to start to read the Bible. As Glenn said, it's available free online, and there'll be some free copies and some resources to help you read it at Leech Hall and at Christchurch as well. We pray that God would reveal himself to you through this. You could also come up to the front of the service at the end, where Sarah, myself, and Glenn, and a few others will be. Life can be hard at times, so we would love to be able to spend some time chatting, listening, and praying with you. We'd also really encourage you to try out some of the churches here in Durham. This is not the last carol service of the season, and churches will have their own, and they would love to invite you to those. If you came with somebody that goes to church, then I'm sure that they would love to take you this Sunday. Or if you didn't, then check out the Carol Service Facebook event, and you can find out more information there about when and where churches are.
Our final prayer for you all is that you would know the Father's love for you, Jesus' desire to save you, and the Spirit's peace and power, that this Christmas would be a time of blessing and joy for you all, and that you would come to know Jesus for yourself.
It's been a joy to be with you this evening for this wonderful carol service. And again, thank you to the magnificent musicians, Glenn, for your powerful word, and for your singing as well, even if one or two of the carols in the section I was in had slightly less traditional words. But we won't worry about that. May God be with you this Christmas. May you be assured of our prayers here at the cathedral for you in all that you do here in this university and when you go home. And so we pray. To you, O Christ, Word of the Father, we offer our prayers and our thanks for your love of humanity, that you most wonderfully chose to be born of Mary in that outhouse in Bethlehem, and took our human nature as nevermore to lay it by, so that we might be born again by your Spirit and restored in the image of God, to whom one blessed Trinity be given all honor, might, majesty, and power, now and forever. Amen. And may the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the Magi, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you evermore. Amen.